Today we have the second of our 2018 Augustana Distinguished Lectures, hosted by the Chester Ronning Center, which are made possible by the Center's Distinguished Visiting Fellows Fund. Our distinguished visitor this year is Dr. Christine Mitchell, professor of Hebrew Scriptures at St. Andrew's College at the University of Saskatchewan, and current president of the Canadian Society of Biblical Studies. As her titles indicate, Christine is a scholar of the Bible, a researcher of texts and their contexts. Last night I shared the titles of some of her works, but for those of you who couldn't make it to yesterday's lecture, I'll share a couple more today. She's the author of numerous publications with articles ranging from the Berlin Papyrus P13447 and the Library of the Yehudite Colony at Elephantine to Coming, Going, and Knowing, Reading Sex and Embodiment in the Hebrew Narrative. I mention these two just to give you a sense of her range of scholarship. She is interested in the history and religions of the Achaemenid Persian Empire, the import of gender studies and feminist hermeneutics in reading the Hebrew Bible, and the roles the Bible has played and continues to play in European colonialist history, among a variety of other topics. She said to me last night that scholars, as they progress through their careers, tend to learn more and more about less and less. But I do not think that this is true of Christine, whose scholarship demonstrates a wide range of interests and expertise. Yesterday, she addressed the issue of genocide in the Hebrew Bible, from the perspective of the ancient world and also our contemporary context. And today, she's prepared a follow-up lecture for us entitled, What to Do with All These Canaanites? A Settler Canadian Reflection on Biblical Conquest Stories. So please welcome me again. Please join me again in welcoming Christine to Augustana.
Thank you very much. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that we are sitting, or in my case standing, on the land of Treaty 6 and the homeland of the Métis. And I would like to thank the Chester Ronning Center and Ian for inviting me, and all of you for coming to here. So I have a little bit of an idea, because there's a little bit of overlap with some of the stuff I did last night. How many people were here last night, or came to be here last night? Okay, so some, but certainly not everybody. Okay. So my outline is kind of a roadmap, rather than a sort of point-by-point kind of outline. And so we're going to begin by thinking about the importance of the question, what to do with all these Canaanites. Think about contexts, the doctrine of discovery, the role of biblical scholarship in all of this, and then look at some texts, some of which I looked at last night and others of which I didn't. Then to think about how we read texts, then to think about some different way we might read texts, and then we'll end up with more questions at the end. So. So on February 9th, 2018, a white farmer was acquitted in Saskatchewan of the murder of a young Indigenous man that occurred on August 25th, 2016. Despite the defense, which was accidental misfire happening as the farmer struggled to remove the keys from the ignition of the young man's car, and despite this defense being actually physically impossible if you tried to do it, I went out to my SUV and actually tried to do this, you can't do it. The all-white jury chose to acquit on both the charge of second-degree murder and the lesser but still serious charge of manslaughter. Importantly, the defense did not argue self-defense. The defense did not argue that the young Indigenous man had threatened the white farmer. Instead, the defense argued that it was an accident, that the farmer's gun, which was being used only to try to frighten the young man and his friends, not to harm them, malfunctioned. The mere presence on the farm of Indigenous individuals had led this white farmer to retrieve that handgun, a weapon with no purpose other than to harm human beings. Their mere presence signaled danger to him, and their presence alone had to be eliminated. My question in the title of my talk is, what to do with all these Canaanites? In one way, it's a rhetorical question because the answer in the biblical text is pretty clear. You kill them all. In another way, it's a very serious question that a number of biblical books, primarily Deuteronomy, Joshua, and Judges, end up working through. And my title is also a response to a 1989 essay by Robert Allen Warrior, Reading Like a Canaanite, which is the earliest scholarly article that I know of that reads the biblical conquest stories in an explicitly suspicious hermeneutic that is contextual and reader-centered. In that essay, Warrior positions himself as an American Christian, indigenous man, who identifies far more with the Canaanites than with the Israelite chosen people that his faith tells him he should identify with. He demonstrates in his reading that for an indigenous person of the Americas, it's not a big leap to read the biblical conquest narratives as directly applicable to one's own experience. I cannot position myself as a Canaanite when I read these texts. My ancestors came to what is now Canada at various points between the 1630s and the 1920s. Some of them came fleeing famine in Iceland in the late 19th century. That would be the extreme paleness of this face. Some of them were brought from Germany in the 1750s to populate Nova Scotia in the wake of the expulsion of others of my ancestors who were Acadians and who had been removed from their farms. And one branch of the family ended up in Prince Edward Island. All of them benefited from the removal of indigenous people from the land, whether fairly gradually in the Maritimes of the 17th and 18th centuries, or rapidly by means of the numbered treaties on the prairies in the late 19th century. So how are the biblical conquest narratives applicable to my experience and the experience of other settler Canadians? And as a biblical scholar, a Canadian biblical scholar, what are my responsibilities when I read and teach these stories? The Truth and Reconciliation Commission calls to action include a call to the Government of Canada and then a separate call that repeats that same call, but a call to churches and faith groups to repudiate concepts such as the doctrine of discovery and terra nullius that justify European colonization of indigenous lands. Standard histories of these concepts trace them to papal decrees of the 15th century and ultimately back to Augustine's concept of just war in the 5th century, which is part of Augustine's thing, is especially in his work, The Questions on the Heptateuch, where he deals particularly with the book of Joshua. So while the legal basis of these concepts may be explained this way, their continued force as a sort of moral force may be explained through the history of North American colonization by largely British Protestants. Just to note, the reality of French colonization, the French being mostly Catholics, restricted both geographically and temporally, and due to the insular nature of various French Canadian cultures until well into the 20th century, that's restricted the general influence of Catholicism upon Canadian society outside of Quebec. In other words, while I am not denying or downplaying the role of French colonization of North America, as for in one case it is crucial in the formation of Métis identity, I am, for the purposes of this talk, going to highlight the role of British Protestants. So Protestantism, with its emphasis on scripture and its rejection of the authority of the Roman Catholic magisterium, the bishops and popes, plays a crucial role in how the concepts between the doctrine of discovery and terra nullius continue to remain operational in Canadian settler consciousness. The settler ethos evident in both Roman Catholic canon law and Canadian society more generally can be traced back to a particular set of biblical texts. Because of the Protestant argument that scripture interprets itself and that its meaning may be discerned by individuals of faith, There's no fence around the texts that both the Roman Catholic and the Jewish tradition have in terms of how you approach scripture. So they remain present, these texts, for anyone to read and use. Now, this availability is true of all biblical texts, and they all pretty much assume an androcentric slaveholding culture. And it wasn't so very long ago that subjugation of women and ownership of slaves found their basis and moral support in biblical texts. But the qualitative difference, I suggest, is the difference between a set of cultural practices and discourses that are described and regulated as part of everyday life, and practices that are prescribed to have a particular applicability. Okay, what does that mean? That means it's one thing to assume, because everybody does it this way, and you just know that this is just part of life, that women are handed over from father to husband in exchange for bride price. This is part of general cultural practice. And it's quite another in a set of authoritative texts to be commanded to exterminate entire groups of people every once in a while. So, one set of texts in these biblical texts demands this extermination, and many other texts implicitly acknowledge that the extermination was in fact kind of messy and incomplete. And I think this is a rupture or discontinuity that helps us see how artificial and fantastic the nature of the command to exterminate actually is. So, given all of that, that we have biblical texts that command colonization and extermination, and a history in North America of exactly those actions being taken upon indigenous peoples of the land, what are we to do? Ignoring these texts or refusing to deal with them is not a viable strategy, as it leaves these texts available for others. Ignoring racism doesn't make it go away, as much as we might like to think so. Second option is leaving the texts to religious communities to deal with. But this cedes responsibility for how these texts continue to function in the non-religious sphere in Canada. Canada is increasingly a secular country, and it has a large non-Christian population, either people of other faiths or people of no faith. But a majority of Canadians, 67% in the 2011 National Household Survey, still identify as Christian. Yet with weekly church attendance below 20%, even if churches do careful and assiduous work, most Canadians will not be part of conversations about these texts. My math is correct, it means only about 15% of Canadians would actually have access, and this is assuming that churches do their work, that only 15% of Canadians would have this kind of access. So, the third option, working with these texts in the public sphere to decolonize them, I think is the only responsible option. All biblical scholars in Canada, whether employed in public or church-related schools, have responsibility for leading the efforts to dismantle the biblical bases of the doctrine of discovery and terra nullius. And the next part of my talk will show my initial efforts in doing this work. Oh, I think I hit one of these other buttons.
Avoid the other
So there's two bodies of text to deal with. One set's largely from Deuteronomy, Joshua, and Judges, while the second is from Chronicles and Ezra, Nehemiah. The first set largely deals with invasion and settlement of the Promised Land by the Israelites, and the second set largely deals with the Judahites' removal from and return to the land after the Babylonian conquest. All right, so what does that mean? So, if we're talking about the latter, removal from or return to the land after the Babylonian conquest, biblical scholars and historians agree that the destruction of Jerusalem and its surrounding territory in 586 BCE and the forced migration of the Judahite elite to Babylon is a historical fact. It is, however, historically unlikely that the invasion and settlement of the Promised Land as described in the book of Joshua actually took place. Nevertheless, in the self-understanding of the authors of these biblical texts, this Israelite conquest of Canaan did happen. And since it's only been really settled by scholars in the last 30 years, where we can really say, I mean, even when I was still an undergrad, we still learned various different models for the conquest. But now I think we can say that it has been settled that the Joshua conquest stories are not historical in the modern sense. But we can safely assume that the vast majority of readers from antiquity until today have seen these texts as a reflection of historical events. But today, it is the rhetorical and ideological effects of these stories that are important, and not whether historians agree on their historicity, so I'm not going to talk about that anymore. So, the text that prescribes invasion, conquest, and extermination of the indigenous Canaanites is Deuteronomy 20, verses 10 to 20, but I've given you 10 to 17. The last three verses talk about how you don't hurt the trees. So it's also known as one of the texts justifying holy war. So there are two prescriptions, the first prescriptions on this screen. For towns and territories outside of the area that's been claimed by God for the Israelites. And this requires pacification of these peoples by surrender or by conquest. Those that surrender enter into servitude, while those that resist are punished but not exterminated. The second prescription is for those towns and territories inside the land claimed by God for the Israelites. And it requires extermination of these indigenous peoples, regardless of whether they resist. The reason for both of these prescriptions is made clear at the end. The mere presence of these people of the indigenous inhabitants is a danger because they may teach the Israelites abhorrent and sinful practices. The indigenous inhabitants of the areas outside the Promised Land do not pose the same risk, and so you only have to subjugate them, you don't have to exterminate them. But what's important to note is that it's only a risk. The indigenous inhabitants of the Promised Land are only theoretically dangerous. Yet, even so, their presence cannot be tolerated. Cherokee scholar Laura Donaldson has demonstrated English, especially Puritan settlers in the what's now the United States, in the 17th and 18th centuries, used the rhetoric of the Promised Land in a number of ways. To speak about their own sense of redemption from persecution, to be sure, but also to justify their occupation of and domination over the indigenous inhabitants of the land. The two are sides of the same coin. Liberation and occupation. The idea that the indigenous people are dangerous not because they might resist being dispossessed of their lands and settlements, and that's entirely a reasonable thing to expect of them, but simply by virtue of their potential for corrupting the settlers, comes right from Deuteronomy 20. The books following Deuteronomy, Joshua and Judges, which are the books of Joshua and Judges, are an extended reflection on the impossibility of fully realizing the vision of Deuteronomy in all its aspects. And I'm just going to look at the one particular aspect, which is the occupation of the land. The story of the trickery of the Hivites living in the settlement of Gibeon in Joshua 9, I've only given you the last bit of it, provides the best example pertaining directly to the prescriptions of Deuteronomy 20. Somehow, the Gibeonites have discovered the exact wording of the commands of Deuteronomy 20, and they actually quote them earlier in the chapter. And they cleverly disguise themselves as indigenous inhabitants from outside the Promised Land, and then they make their way to Joshua. They've got ragged clothes and moldy bread. Look, we've come from a long way away. No, we have not come from the town just down the road. We've come from far, far away, so we would like to make a treaty with you. And Joshua, Moses' successor, agrees. He finds out later that it's a trick. But because they've entered into a treaty, which is a sacred agreement sworn before God, he decides not to kill them, even though they're indigenous peoples inside the Promised Land, but instead to make them slaves, which is supposed to be better. So there are two things that stand out here for me. First, he doesn't back out of the treaty. But remember that the prescription regarding indigenous peoples outside the promised land commanded that such people become forced laborers. So he makes them forced laborers on their own land. The second thing that stands out is the phrase hewers of wood and drawers of water. Hewers of wood and drawers of water, which is often used in the Canadian context, but to connote the resource-based economy of this country. It was introduced into the Canadian lexicon in Minister of Finance Leonard Tilley's 1879 budget speech, should you be interested, and continues to be used in this manner to this day. If you Google the phrase, as I did, you will find, you know, articles from the Globe and Mail from 2015 talking about, you know, Canada no longer hewers of wood and drawers of water, or Canada still hewers of wood and drawers of water. So, but it's also been used to describe the position of the majority of Quebecois exploited by Anglophone Canada. It's hewers of wood and drawers of water on their own land. I have never seen this phrase, and I'd be very interested to know if any of you have. I have never seen this phrase used to refer to indigenous peoples or groups. And yet in Joshua 9, that is exactly to whom the phrase applies. And it says a lot about Canada when either Canadians as a whole or the Quebecois see themselves as being colonized and subjugated, condemned to servitude in the land they see as their own, but that they've actually taken from somebody else. Continuing through the book of Joshua, chapter 11 demonstrates both the obedience to divine command in the extermination of the indigenous inhabitants of the promised land, and the recognition that, in fact, the extermination was not complete and some survived. By continually referring to the Hivites of Gibeon, the story subtly reminds us that they gained their safety through trickery and therefore cannot be trusted. They are always in the land, potentially dangerous and contaminating, yet cannot be exterminated because we made a sacred treaty. The end of the book of Joshua has Joshua's farewell speech. And it's very long, and I've given you some selected bits of it. Two points are relevant. First, a reminder that God had prepared the land for the people by destroying the indigenous inhabitants by a plague. Second, that the promised land was a gift to people who had not done the work to make it suitable for human habitation, and who in fact profited from the labor of others. Parallels to the Canadian experience are obvious and probably don't need to be spelled out. However, the text makes a point here and elsewhere of the very fact that the Israelites profit from taking this land. The people's response to the promise is to serve the God that had made this gift. Now, as a settler myself, can I believe that God made me a gift of this land? Clearly, my forebears, maybe not them as individuals, but as a group, my forebears believed that. And the doctrine of discovery is part of that belief. But can I continue to believe that today? No, I cannot. And the text of Joshua doesn't believe it either. If the land were truly a gift, it would have been empty of indigenous inhabitants. War would not have been required in order to occupy. So the text of Joshua has a paradox. The land is a gift, but it must be taken. Normally, you don't have to take gifts. Gifts are given to you. But it must be taken and then guarded with extreme vigilance. Joshua's paradox, the book of Joshua's paradox, shows up in Canadian stories and justifications for the settlement of the land. It is a gift, perhaps not from God, but from European 17th through 19th century technological advantage. But it must be taken and guarded from the remaining indigenous inhabitants. The book of Judges adds one little additional component to the narrative of occupation. The indigenous inhabitants had not been eradicated. There's already been a hint of that in Joshua. But their presence is now explained as part of God's plan. Their presence has two purposes. First, to give the people practice in forms of violence. And second, to be the means by which the people's own worthiness might be measured. The people fail, of course, as you know, people do, But by providing the indigenous inhabitants of the land as the form of the temptation that leads to failure, that failure's softened. There's the unspoken wish running through the Book of Judges that if only we'd wiped them out, they wouldn't be causing us to sin. This may be familiar to you as blaming the victim. So, the second set of biblical texts that I now turn to gives the rationale for empty land theology, that is, terra nullius. So, dealt with doctrine of discovery, now biblical basis for terra nullius. The conquest of Jerusalem, its destruction by the Babylonians under Nebuchadnezzar, and the removal of the elites, not that they wanted to go, to Babylon in 586 BCE is explained in two ways across the entire corpus of biblical texts. One is familiar just from our brief examination of Deuteronomy, Joshua, and Judges. The people sinned and they were punished. And this is the form that their punishment took. And a remnant of the population was left in the land according to 2 Kings 25, which I did not put up here. That's one explanation. But the other one that I'm going to focus on posits a buildup of cultic impurity in the land as described in Leviticus 26 as something that might happen. And then 2 Chronicles 36 takes the language of Leviticus 26 and basically says this is what has happened. So there's a buildup of nasty stuff, cultic impurity, like gunk in your drains or something like that. And in order to make it right, the land has to have its rest, its Sabbath. And when applied to the story of the destruction and forced removal, one version of which says there were people left in the land, 2 Chronicles 36 has the land remaining completely empty of human life. All the days that it lay desolate, it kept Sabbath. Fulfill 70 years. The descendants of those who have been forced to move to Babylon are those who are chosen by imperial decree here to repopulate the land. The land was empty, just waiting to be re-inhabited. However, the returning elites soon find that there are in fact people living in this land, and it wasn't empty at all. And not only was it not empty, the people in it claimed kinship and ethnic ties to these returning elites. We're your cousins. They were Judahites and Israelites. So the rhetorical and ideological trick for dealing with them is kind of neat in the Book of Ezra. It's not pleasant, but it's neat. The peoples of the lands are equated with those horrible, defiling indigenous inhabitants in Deuteronomy. So, the people of Israel, priests and Levites, have not separated themselves from the peoples of the lands whose abominations are like those of the Canaanites, Hittites, Perizzites, Jebusites, Ammonites, Moabites, Egyptians, and Amorites. Which is a slightly different list than we see in Deuteronomy because Ezra doesn't have Deuteronomy right in front of him and he's making some stuff up on the fly. So, some translations, including the NRSV, which is why I slightly modified it here, some translations leave out the like, and they say, have not separated themselves from the people of the lands, have not separated themselves from the people of the lands who have abominable practices. And then there's a colon, and then it gives a list of people. So it makes them seem like there are still Canaanites, Hittites, Perizzites, Jebusites, etc. still in the land. But actually, it's a nifty little rhetorical trick to make the ideological basis for erasing the Judahites, because these are Judahites, these are Ezra's cousins, who did not share Ezra's community's experience of forced migration. So their claim to the land is negated by equating them with indigenous people. Ideologically, for the Book of Ezra now, the land is empty. Nifty trick. Alright. Hermeneutics of suspicion. The mode of reading that Paul Ricoeur termed the hermeneutics of suspicion has become the dominant one in the humanities over the past 40 years. Any of us with a graduate degree in humanities and social sciences can do it. For many of us, it's our default mode. It assumes that texts and other cultural products mask their own ideological bases, or if they're not masked, their bases are repressed. A text may seem to be about one thing, but it's really about something else. This mode of reading assumes that the objects we study are inherently untrustworthy or untrustable, but that the astute, trained reader with a graduate degree and many years of student loans can see through the mask or the repression and point to the text's meaning. So recently, I've been pondering Eve Kosofsky-Sedgwick's essay on paranoid reading, which has been increasingly cited since its print publication in 2003. Her take on the hermeneutics of suspicion is to call it paranoid reading, and two quotations are striking. First, she notes, it's strange that a hermeneutic of suspicion would appear trusting about the effects of exposure. This is true. Once we've peeled back the mask to expose the pernicious violence of the text's ideology, our work is done, right? As scholars, yes. Simply airing it out will put an end to it. But as she argues, this is manifestly not the case, right? If that were the case, there would be no racism in Canada. We've been doing this, let's all be friends stuff now for a good 40 years. Are we all still friends? No, we are not. She then goes on to say, what does a hermeneutics of suspicion and exposure have to say to social formations in which visibility itself constitutes much of the violence? The violence in these biblical texts we've been reading is not hidden. It is there. It is evident. It's not hard to see or find. We had to do a little bit of careful reading and correct some quite horrid mistranslation to pick up the subtle construction of Ezra's Judahite opponents as being equivalent to Canaanites, but it's not hidden. It's very clear. The violence is visible. There is nothing to suspect or expose. And it's part of that visibility of it that actually makes it violent. And I might suggest, gently perhaps, so that I don't offend people's sensibilities, that the reaction of many well-intentioned settler Canadians to the TRC is congruent to those people who trust in the effects of exposure. We've heard the truth, so that's enough to lead to reconciliation, right? It's been exposed, it's out there now. Now we can all be friends and get along. But I think Sedgwick was right. The hermeneutics of suspicion and exposure cannot address, it hasn't addressed, deep and systemic injustices and racism of Canadian colonial society. So what to do? Sedgwick went on in her essay to argue for a turn to reparative reading, which she doesn't really define all that much. Closest she comes to it is the two quotations I put up here. She died reasonably young for a scholar, so this cut off anything else she might have said. So scholars who have taken up the challenge of thinking about what reparative reading might look like have gone in two different directions. One is so-called surface reading, celebrates the aesthetics of the text. I think there's a lot of ethical problems with that, so we're just going to put that one aside. And the second approach that scholars are taking is reading with empathy and love. And the latter, reading with empathy and love, is more consistent with Sedgwick's work as a queer theorist, which is what she primarily was. As a queer theorist, she was positioned to locate and celebrate how her community was able to find something in the surrounding culture that could still be nourishing to the community, to her community. But as a settler Canadian, I'm not positioned to prescribe how sustenance might be extracted by Indigenous people from settler culture. And as I was reviewing this paper in the last week, I was also following the results of the trial of Raymond Cormier in the murder of Tina Fontaine in Winnipeg. And according to media reports, after the not guilty verdict was announced, family members of Tina Fontaine huddled in the courtroom and someone began reciting the Lord's Prayer. As an observer, for me, looking at that from the outside through a media report, this act to me seems to be a small example of sustenance extracted from a culture whose avowed desire has been not to sustain Indigenous selves and communities. But I can only observe it, I can't prescribe it. I am not positioned to do that. So, as a settler, what options do I have? In 2015 and 2017, I had the opportunity to spend some time in Berlin, which of course has its own problematic history of oppression and violence, in the 20th century in particular. As a site of memory, the city seems to be a layering of effects, or as Sedgwick calls it, it's accretive and additive. Examples include, and I don't want to take too much more of your time, so I'm not going to explain the amazing things that I think about these monuments, but include the Victory Column in the Tiergarten, which was originally put up in the 19th century. Hitler wanted it made taller, so he had his architect put on a fourth drum, which was then not removed after the fall of the Third Reich in 1945. The pieces, the bronze pieces, commemorate the Franco-Prussian War of the 1870s, but you can see that there's bullet holes, there's mortar holes, there's all kinds. These have not been restored. So whose victory are we talking about here? And this is, to me, this is amazing as how it is left. Then there's the Topography of Terror, which is a museum located in the ruins of the former SS headquarters. There's the Memorial to the Murdered Jews of Europe. The site, Hitler's Chancellery, is actually the site of it. I mean, it's a parking lot playground now, but the site is in the background, and it is a stone's throw from the German Parliament. And this one I particularly like because we have Frederick the Great of Prussia, you know, great imperialist conqueror. And then right across the street is the Bebelplatz book burning memorial, because that is the spot where probably the most famous of the book burnings took place. And the memorial is a room sunken in a below ground with bookshelves, and the shelves are large enough to they have enough space to contain all of the books that were burnt that day in the Bebelplatz. So it's this layer. We don't take down Frederick, but we stick, you can draw a pretty straight line from Frederick's imperialist ideas to book burnings, and they're right across the, this didn't have to be a consequence of this, but it was, and they're right across the street from each other, so that's pretty cool. And then the East Side Gallery on the remnants of the Berlin Wall. This is Brezhnev and Honecker kissing each other here. And then the day that my husband, who was with me, went to see the East Side Gallery, we had artists working on doing some new pieces on it, so kind of neat. So. So the past is not eradicated, nor is it celebrated. It's remembered. And is this a way forward for dealing with biblical texts that call for eradication of indigenous inhabitants of a promised land? Already, the biblical text itself is layered. The prescriptions in Deuteronomy are not fully actualized in Joshua, and then they're reinterpreted in Judges and reapplied in Ezra. And can I add, can we add more layers to these texts, so much that it becomes impossible to strip away those layers? I do not know, but I do know that simply exposing these texts is not an option, nor is simply ignoring them. And perhaps remembering them is only the first step. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Christine, for a very insightful talk. I'll open the floor now for comments, questions for Christine.
I come from an overtly political background, so if I have any religious ignorances, please excuse me. But In regards to your sort of comparison between the Deuteronomy, Joshua, and Judges, and the settler pushing on land, do you feel that those kind of ideological ideas are echoed in formal policy of the federal government?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. So Leonard Tilley, who gave us hewers of wood and drawers of water, also gave us Dominion of Canada, drawn from Psalm 72.
Pretty explicit.
So, yeah, it's from Psalm 72. And in Psalm 72, it's that God has dominion over the whole world. But he picks that phrase out and applies it to. And then it got picked out. It's an interesting one because Canada was the first self-governing dominion, right, of the British Empire. But the terminology of dominion then came to be used by the British for their for Australia, for New Zealand, for South Africa, in the next few decades after Confederation here. So, yeah.
Thank you.
One of the themes through the Old Testament is that retributive theology, and that if Israel is faithful, they will prosper, and if they are not faithful, i.e. intermingled with other peoples, other faiths, and their practices, they'll be punished. So how do you set what you've said against that larger picture?
And how they will be punished is by losing the land.
Yes.
So that's, and I think there's that kind of unspoken fear that lies underneath Canadian colonial settler ideology, that if we are not faithful, we will lose that land. And in the meantime, we've got to show how faithful we are by taking it and holding on to it really tight. So, yes.
And of course, one of the fears, I think, I don't know whether it's spoken publicly very much or not, is that if we really take this truth and reconciliation stuff seriously, are we going to have to give back some of the land?
Exactly.
And that, then it's going to pinch.
Yeah.
It's one thing to go to a powwow.
It's one thing to go to a powwow. It's one thing to go to a lecture like this one. It's one thing to, you know, read a newspaper column. It's another thing to think about how do we actually, as a nation, take reconciliation seriously. And for all of the horrible flaws of the ideology of the Book of Joshua, and there are many, one is actually really, I think, helpful, which is the one where he actually keeps the treaty, which the terms of the treaty are not great for the Hivites of Gibeon, but Joshua keeps it because it's sacred and does not abrogate the treaty, and we haven't even done that. Before we start getting all snippy about how Joshua is bloodthirsty, we might look in the mirror ourselves. I think it's something to reflect on.
Well, since no one else is chomping into it.
Chomp away.
I'm a dual citizen. I grew up in the States, and I've lived in Canada for 30-some years now. In the States, this whole concept is very, well, maybe it's not explicit anymore, but it's very close to the surface. It's called Manifest Destiny.
Yep.
12 original colonies equals the 12 tribes of Judah. So is Manifest Destiny part of the Canadian lexicon?
Not explicitly, but you have to remember that the first large wave of English-speaking settlers to Canada came from the United States. in 1784, 83 and 84, the fall fleet and the spring fleet. There were small pockets in Nova Scotia. There were, because Nova Scotia had been taken from the French, parts of it in 1710, and then other parts of it in 1749. And then there were some, colonial officers and so forth in Quebec after 1763. But the big sort of wave, the first big wave of English-speaking colonists to Canada came from the United States. And they brought that with them, even though that had not been fully developed yet in the United States. But so I think that's why it doesn't manifest quite the same way in Canada, but the roots of it are still there. Those Congregationalist preachers of the 18th century who were preaching that, it was a light on a hill and all of that stuff.
We're here to save the world.
Exactly, and they brought that with them.
Thank you. As a person who fits into the British Protestant, as my accent suggests, I'm just wondering how, and this may be a very academic question, if we don't follow through at this point with the TRC, looking back in history, there aren't a lot of situations where there had been truth and reconciliation. And these people that came over from, and I'm not justifying anything, but these people that came over from Europe have had centuries of waves of of their own injuries and their own atrocities not being recognized. If we don't follow through with the TRC, where do you see Canadian culture going? And is it not... Not that it's not imperative, but is it imperative that we do it? And where will communities go if we don't do it?
Well, that's an excellent question. I wish I knew the answer. I'm just a biblical scholar. I'm a Canadian biblical scholar. I have ancestors, as I said, who showed up in the tidal flats of the Annapolis Valley in the 1630s. But all the way to my grandfather, who came from Nottingham as a four-year-old in 1924. But some of them were wronged. So, I mean, nifty little story, one of the little ironies of history kind of things. So I have Acadian ancestors, and they were, of course, deported. In the 1750s from Nova Scotia. I also have, they're called the foreign Protestants. They're the Germans and Swiss who were Protestants, who were brought by the British to colonize Nova Scotia after Louis Bourque fell in 1749. So they came in the 1750s, and one of the first things that set of ancestors had to do was trot themselves across the province to get the cattle that had been abandoned by the Acadians when they were expelled, and bring that back because they were told, well, there will be cattle for you. So one set of ancestors is taking the cattle that the other set of the ancestors was deported from looking after. So yes, this is one of those nifty little ironies of history. I don't know what to do about any of this. I know that it's part of my family history. It's why I'm here. I can't right any of those wrongs. All I can do is remember them and then say, well, how do we go forward? Yes, as a settler, we took this land. But someone like me, if you wanted to send me back, I got nowhere to go back to, right? Because I got everything from Nottingham to Iceland to the German-Swiss border to Acadians who are, God knows where, some of them at the bottom of the ocean. So where am I supposed to go back to? I mean, that's just not an option. So we have to go forward. How do we do that? And that I don't know because I'm just a biblical scholar.
Right, and it's just stuff that's floating around my head. Like, growing up in the UK, a Enrique was invaded by the Romans.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, just to pick one.
Yeah, yeah.
You speak to anybody from the UK now, they're proud of their ancestry and that the whole of society is tied up in that. So I just wonder how long a period of time. I'm just.
Well, that one's 2,000 years, so maybe that's what it is. And seriously, maybe that's how long it takes, right?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Just curious, do you know of any indigenous scholars that are asking for or advocating this kind of scriptural reasoning that you're suggesting?
I know biblical scholars, or I don't know them personally, but I know their work. I alluded to two of them who work on these issues. Laura Donaldson's probably the best known one. Columbia, if memory serves. It's like kind of. I'll answer by telling another story, which is that I teach at a United Church of Canada related school in Saskatoon, and one of my colleagues thinks it's. That one of the things we should be doing for our ministry students is doing a course where we bring our ministry students together with Indigenous ministry students, which we already do in other ways, but he wants them to all come together and read biblical stories together. And we keep saying, well, where's that going to fit in the curriculum? And because, you know, there's only so much credits in a degree. And we already have a piece where they actually go to an Indigenous training center and they spend time there working with other ministry students. So would we take that out? Would we complement it? Would we take an elective? Which are questions for us as educators, right? As we think about our curricula in higher education in Canada is, okay, so I'm on the U of S campus. The current U of S president, his big thing is indigenizing the university, indigenizing the university, indigenizing the university. He keeps saying it, nobody knows what that means, and then there's the kind of the practical questions, right? What does that actually mean on the ground? And I don't think any of us have any answers to that. I mean, if you have answers, I'd love to hear those answers.
We're asking the same questions here.
Yeah. What does that mean? We're pretty sure at our place it doesn't mean you just tack a course on. We're pretty sure it doesn't mean that. But what it does mean is hard. And the Indigenous faculty, we don't have any Indigenous faculty. There's only six of us, so. But there's a real problem of overload for Indigenous faculty members in universities around the country. Very similar, I think, to in the fields that I'm in and that Ian's in, women make up somewhere around 20 to 25% of the professoriate. So in our field, women, I can still be the only girl in a room. And so we don't want to do that either. Impose burdens on people who already have lots of burdens. So, yeah, what do? I don't know.
Really interesting thing for all of us. How has the process of colonization unfolded in Canada? The land grab was obviously at the forefront, but the other, you know, big aspect of this was assimilation, and part of that was trying to Christianize.
Yes.
Indigenous.
Yes.
Peoples. And of course, one of the byproducts of that is we have had and still have, you know, a sizable part of the Indigenous population who are Christian.
Yes.
Or who belong to Christian churches.
Yes.
My question is, do you know of any research out there that kind of has looked at how, you know, largely Indigenous Christian churches in Canada deal with these types of texts?
I don't know of any. If I knew, I mean, so the United Church runs, along with us and other theological schools in the country, also operates a training center for indigenous ministry students just outside of Winnipeg. And that was explicitly set up at the request of indigenous members of the church, and it is run by indigenous members of the church. We send our non-indigenous students to it periodically for some work. I don't know of any scholarship in that area. I actually don't know that there are any indigenous biblical scholars in Canada. Nobody says that they have to come up and identify themselves. You know, hi, Christine, and nice to meet you. I am an indigenous biblical scholar. No, but my guess is, well-informed guess, is that there aren't any. And today, this is one of my other pet peeves about biblical scholarship, that with the Protestant and Catholic traditions in Canada largely abrogating their responsibility to teach Bible to the evangelical schools, the chances of indigenous biblical scholarship in Canada arising anytime soon in any kind of sustained way are pretty small. So, which is why the scholars that I do quote are American. There are some.
I was just going to add that I've talked about this with Daniel Sims, who's a history professor here, and he's indigenous. He's from Sake Dene in north central BC. And we've talked about going to his home community and talking to people about issues of biblical interpretation amongst the Christians there.
Yeah.
But again, we have this problem of, like, that's not, he's a historian who works on 19th, 20th century historical issues, but biblical studies is not necessarily his thing. And so by, you know, roping him into some project that I might be interested in, I'm just further burdening one of my indigenous colleagues who's already overburdened as it is. So these are very difficult things to do.
And as part of a colloquium, a group that I'm a part of Indigenous and non-Indigenous scholars thinking about these issues, particularly how they pertain to churches in Canada, you know, one of the things one of the Indigenous members of the group said is, you know, you white folk, you got to get this sorted out yourself. Like, you can't just come to us and ask us what to do. You got to, you know, do some of this, do some of the work yourselves. And, you know, so I've kind of taken that to heart too.
I was reflecting on your saying that rather than removing certain statues that, or, you know, annihilating that, or celebrating that they're there to remember.
Yeah.
And I will go away thinking about that. I think it's important. And also in relation to, many people have had many traumas in their history, in their lives. But to dismiss one because others have had them is really not a happy place. So I was thinking when you said, well, where would you go home to, or where would we all go home to? I was thinking perhaps if we went home to the realization and remember what it is to be abandoned, dismissed, having our lands taken, and maybe that would be a start at home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I ended with, I don't know, like, I don't know what to do now. I know what I can't do. I don't know what to do, and I have to think about that some more. And maybe remembering is, and at this point, maybe that's the first thing I can do is deeper remembering. Yeah, maybe that's all any of us can do at this point. think about that for a while, and then maybe be ready to do something else, which maybe it will come to us at that point, what we do next. So, yeah, thank you.
Given the recognition in these stories that the sort of conquest or annihilation wasn't complete, I'm curious if there's sort of a parallel to be drawn between the Zionist movement and the modern Israel-Palestine conflict.
Yeah, usually when these texts are read today, they are read in that context. So there's been quite a lot of work done on that. The empty land theology and the settlement of and the formation of the modern state of Israel, for instance. There's been quite a bit of work done on that. So yeah, that's out there. And that's, yeah, when people are talking about these texts today, they're either talking about them in that context or they're talking about them in the sort of general ethics of divine violence kind of sense. You know, is it okay that every now and then God is violent? So, which God certainly seems to be. So, yes. Yeah.
Would you say more about that? That's a new one.
So one of the things that gets a lot of very liberal Christians and Jews quite upset is the fact that God is A, violent, and B, advocates violence in a number of biblical texts, which to liberal Western sensibilities is certainly my students find my courses scary, first of all because I'm supposed to be scary, and secondly because the material I teach is supposed to be scary. So there's been quite a lot of work in the last 15 years or so on the ethics of divine violence, like, and some of it is, so some of it is by biblical scholars, some of it is by systematic theologians who don't know how to read the Bible but think they do, and which is a common complaint that biblical scholars have about systematic theologians, and I apologize to any systematic theologians who may be in the room whom I have offended. There's a lot of, so what do we do with this violent God? And so some of it is, well, you know, they kind of deserved it, which in any other sphere of our lives is not an appropriate response. Another common response, the one that I sort of can see, I can agree with, is that anger and violence is sometimes justified in response to injustice, right? So that if we see injustice, we can, although Canadians love to do this, oh, that's okay, I know you didn't mean it, you know, we'll just all be friends now. No, sometimes it's actually okay to be angry at injustice, and that when we see an angry and sometimes violent God in response to injustice, you know, how else is God supposed to be if people are acting unjustly? Oh, that's all right, here, have a cookie. There is room for that kind of anger, and when you put it like that, people kind of see that. Oh right, yeah. So sometimes I get angry with my kid or my niece or nephew because they've done something which could have harmed another person, and so the proper response is actually that I am angry to let them know how serious this was and don't do it again. Or that when I see injustice in the world, it's actually appropriate that I be angry about it because that anger spurs me to action. And so, same with God.
Like Bonhoeffer.
Yes, like Bonhoeffer. Of course, he didn't end very well, so, you know. It's like I tell my students, are you really sure you really want to be Jesus? You know how Jesus ended up, right? So, how angry do you want to be, and what are the consequences you are willing to endure as a result of your actions and your anger?
Any others?
I can't edit this thing. I mean, we have lots of answers to how we can proceed. You know, 25 years ago, we had the Royal Commission.
Absolutely.
You know, we've got the Truth and Reconciliation 96.
Yeah.
We have Luther's 90 theses on the wall.
Yeah.
We have a whole transformation of the German nation after World War II that's
exactly.
You know, we label this as hate literature.
Yeah.
Say stop it now.
Yeah.
Can't do this anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
Talk to our neighbors. Find out. You know what struck me last night. It was like a piercing to my heart when I heard you talk about that this covenant was for the land of milk and honey, which my mother called this land as a German immigrant coming here. And knowing how that could be an offensive way of calling Canada when I'm with my Indigenous neighbors, I never realized how hurtful calling that metaphor up would be to someone who's been beaten by a same residential school. So I think it's part of that willingness to face. However much we try, we can cause harm. And it's in the trying of relationship that we reconcile. And to use this extreme of, oh, well, if we start that process, it might mean we will lose our land. Well, it doesn't have to get that way, you know? That's that logic is often used to stop people from resisting. Oh, don't be Dietrich Bonhoeffer, you might be martyred. Well, you actually might become friends and form a true covenant and say that, you know, this is what happened on this land before European conquest. You know, the Six Nations formed the Confederation of which, on which Canada's peace ordering and government started. Mm-hmm. So to be self-selective and sort of stopping us before even attempting seems to me not having the courage to try.
There's a lot of lessons, I think, which is why I put the stuff from Berlin up there. There's a lot of lessons for settler Canadians from Berlin. You can't put up a statue of Hitler in Germany. That is illegal, okay? But they didn't necessarily dismantle the things that were there, and instead layered them with other types of meaning. So I think there's something we can learn from that, and I think, yeah, other people have done work in similar kinds of circumstances, and we can learn, I think, a lot from that. As Canadians, oh, especially the current Prime Minister, who's so sure that the world needs more of us, and I'm sure he's a great guy and everything, sometimes we need to shut up for a while and listen to what other people have to say, because sometimes we're not all that. And there are lessons that other people have for us.
Well, and actually owning how very racist the Canadian policy has been, not only Indigenous, but to immigrant policy. You know, we just have to read some of our own historical documents in that context. I guess, if anything, to simply own it and say, it is hate literature. Let's stop it now. Let's change.
And the only way to actually deal with hate literature is to ban it. And, I mean, there's lots of ways to not deal with it. But, for example, if you compare Germany to some of the surrounding nations in terms of the size of their far-right movements, the German one is a lot smaller. So that's correlation, maybe, and not causation, and it's anecdote and, you know, whatever, but it says something that maybe you ban stuff that is actually hateful. And don't just say, let's have a hug. So, which is our response a lot of times.
We're here at Augustana, which I know obviously is an educational institution, and I'm sitting here amongst community members and colleagues. I mean, I have a colleague of English literature and a political science here and another biblical scholar, and you mentioned early on, like, you know, just brushing this all under the rug,
yeah,
ignoring it isn't going to help.
No, no.
Leaving it to other people to read isn't going to help either.
No.
And if we look at the statistics you mentioned, so 67% of Canadians identify with Christianity.
Yeah.
Which, so let's take that number. That means maybe two-thirds of Canadians at least know the story of Joshua and Jericho, or they heard it in Sunday school or something at some point. But only 15% of those, or 15% overall,
yes,
are actively involved in churches.
Yeah.
So if we leave it to the churches, say,
yeah,
and theological educational institutions,
yeah,
to struggle with these problems, we're only reaching a very small portion of Canada.
Yes.
But this is a call to me to keep talking about these things in the class, keep unpacking them for our political scientists and our English scholars to continue, and our my fellow biblical scholars, to continue educating young Canadians about these issues, to contextualize them historically, to remember them, and to build from there. Right? So I think we are doing things, right? I know, like, we don't want to walk away just throwing up our hands and saying,
yeah,
even though we feel that way a lot.
And I'm an academic, right? Like, that's all I know how to do. I'm a scholar. I'm really useless at most stuff. This I can do. So this is my contribution, right? You contribute as according to your gifts and abilities. So this is what I can do. Somebody else can do something in a different way.
Yeah. Well,
so,
I think we're uniquely positioned to interact with a lot of people who can do things in different kinds of ways.
Yeah.
And we can make our contribution, and then they can make their contribution, and
exactly,
we can learn from them. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I want to thank you and
thank you.
Applaud you.